As Mr. Flavor, I am proud to bring to you Mr. E, the music maestro.
Yes, Angela McCall was stronger, meaning that you gotta be strong in this thing, you feel me? First, let me introduce myself. This is your boy, Mr. E, Boss of the South Side. Boss is bringing to you live. Hold on, let me turn off this fan real quick because I realized how loud that thing was. Anyway, but you know what this is? This is Passion Hour here on BOSS Radio, where we like to bring y'all nothing but the underground hits of R&B, Passion, and and more jazz, you name it, and we got it for you. You hear? Even spoken word, which we're not really going to play tonight. Because we got some old spoken word that we got to talk about tonight. You know what I'm saying? We got in the studio right now. We got your boy King Guru in this bitch.
Holding it down.
What it is, King? How you feeling tonight, man?
Man, popping off. Make sure I got everything held for myself. And I'm going to make sure we all good for 2020 summer. It's going to keep on going.
Exactly.
It's going to keep on going.
Exactly. And that's why we have to come at y'all with this conversation tonight. Because we got a lot of conversations out there with people who... Actually, you know, this conversation actually has to be discussed, and we might even bring because we're gonna do it from the male perspective tonight, and we still are, but we're gonna bring a special guest. You know, y'all already know who she is. She's the most one of my best guests on the show. Matter of fact, my co-host on the show, Connie Lofton. I'm sorry, Connie Mora. I don't know if she's listening to this right now. Expect a phone call here in a moment because we're going to need your input real quick on the conversation that we got at hand. So I definitely hope you're ready for that. You know what I'm talking about? Because we got to have this from both perspectives. You know, the conversation is pretty much, does romance belong in relationships? And if so, how can the relationship, how can romance help build that relationship? Because we've been finding out a lot of people have been getting into relationships and not knowing exactly what, you know, how to keep it going. They figure they got that person, so now they don't have to worry about, oh, that person never going anywhere, or you know they don't ever keep up the game. I mean, you gotta it don't matter who you
system. It's like a computer system. You gotta update it. Yes. I mean, Google something. I mean, it's out there for you.
Exactly. Exactly. It's out there. That's why you gotta make sure that you can get a hold of it. You know what I'm saying? That's why we're here, and we're gonna be discussing if romance really still belong in the relationship. And if you don't believe that, y'all can hit us up on our chat right now. Right now, we got Connie Moore right now chatting with us right now. You know what I'm saying about this. So, you know, hold on 1 minute, Connie. I'm loading up some more music right now. So just give me a minute. Okay, but yeah, she loves the topic, so she definitely is in on it. So we're gonna play some more music while we go ahead and get Connie online, and then when we come back, we're gonna have a real discussion about what it means in order to be in this in a relationship with somebody with no romance, you know, because I really feel like romance should be in it, but you know, but until then, let's go ahead and play some music. We got some great underground music right now. This first one right here is a reason I believe that romance should stay in it, because you wouldn't do any of this if you was actually, you know, having romance. So, Connie, we finna hit you up in just a moment. And while we do that, everybody else that's listening to BOSS Radio, hit y'all gonna hear some great music. If you really want to get in on this conversation, hit us up at www.spreaker.mr_e. If you want a quicker link to that, just look us up at Southside Boss Connection on Facebook. We got the link there. Click it. Come on over. Holla at us. We want to see y'all in the chat box. Let us know what you think about romance in the relationship. You feel me? Already. So we're going to be hitting it up. Hey, you already know, Connie. We're going to hit you up in just a moment. You feel me? This is Cheap Man Blues here on BOSS Radio, baby. Follow us on Instagram and on Facebook at Southside Boss Connection. You can follow me personally at Mr. E the Gutter Baby or at One Gutter Baby on Facebook, and Boss of the Southside Bosses on Instagram. King Guru, where can they find you at?
Man, I'll be posted up on Reverb Nation / REDE. Or you can catch me on Facebook, you know, King Guru. Shit, I also got a couple of things coming out this year. It's 2020. I guess it started time merchandise and started to brand myself. So definitely, man, if you can hit me up on Naval American on Facebook, you know what I'm saying, come join the team.
That's real. That's Naval American on Facebook. So y'all make sure y'all tune in to that, because it's going down, baby. I'm telling y'all, man, ain't going to get no better than this. Already, Cheap Man Blues, followed by Gangsta Love here on BOSS Radio, baby. You already know what it is.
I gave you my money and got you out of jail. I gave you my nookie, then you told me to go to hell. I got the blues. Now you got me feeling angry. Ooh, baby, don't
Jay Smooth.
Stick up.
soothing fragrance redeeming my soul, leading to my divine destiny. Nothing can keep me down. I refuse to stay bound. Gravity does not have a hold on me.
As Mr. Flavor, I am proud to bring to you Mr. E, the Music Maestro.
Already, that was Delinda with Free to Fly. Because you know what? Everybody should be free to fly. It doesn't matter if you're in a relationship or you're single. You should be free to fly. Because if you can't fly, then you have been knocked down to the bottom of the totem pole. You know, that's just how I feel. So that's why I feel like this is actually a good song for what we're talking about right now. Because a lot of people, like, okay, again, you know, first, we have to actually satisfy the lawyer. So first, let me, since we have multiple. Connie, you want to introduce yourself real quick?
Sure. This is Connie Moore with MoxO Radio. Hello, everyone.
Already, so you know we're gonna have a great discussion tonight, boy, because it's gonna be going down. I'm telling y'all, man, for real. But you know, before we do that, let's go ahead and satisfy the lawyers and get this disclaimer shit out the way. You know, that way we can say whatever we want to say, and BOSS Radio and Southside Bosses can't get sued. You know, so give us another minute, ladies and gentlemen, and we will be right back. BOSS Radio, Southside Bosses, its owners and associates take no responsibility for the opinions or statements made by the talk show host or their guests. Statements or show topics are not necessarily the beliefs of the site or the radio station, and opinions between talk show hosts may conflict. This site does not endorse anything as the truth that you will have to judge for yourself. But we try to speak the truth on the owner's behalf and reserve the right to question the supposed truth. In this time of misinformation, government-controlled media, and government corruption, it is sometimes hard to get to the truth, but we must try. It is not our intention to libel, discriminate, make hate, or annoy anyone. We believe that it is our constitutional First Amendment right of free speech to voice our opinions and our duty to the Constitution and country to expose the truth. This site takes no responsibility for the opinions of others and the postings of comments in chat rooms or forum posts. And that's how we get down over here. Now that we got the legalities out the way, let's go ahead and get down to it. Now, the topic we want to talk about right now is pretty much romance in a relationship. Is it needed or is it not needed? And we there's so many different ways that we can look at this, you know, because relationships come in all shapes and sizes. You know, there's platonic relationships, there's romantic relationships, there's professional relationships, so on and so forth. It doesn't matter. How do we feel about romance in a romantic relationship? Somebody you're supposed to be spending the rest of your life with. Me personally, I feel like romance should be an everyday thing when it comes to the person that you want to spend the rest of your life with. And the reason why I say that is because things can get boring. We were talking about money earlier, and we were talking about how money can go stale, you know, by just sitting there. You know, if it's just sitting there, it goes stale. And we can get into all the economic thing on True Heritage, on Revolutionary Hour. But I feel like when it comes to that, love is the same way. In order for love to exist, it got to be some kind of romance. But what if there's a different kind of relationship at hand? So I just want to ask, we got Connie Moore on the line right now. I want Connie, we were talking about a little something about a different type of relationships. Can you break that down for us a little bit?
Well, I mean, there's different types of relationships because you have to understand people get into relationships for different reasons, okay? Now, we've got those people that are just looking for someone to take care of them, which, you know, we're in 2020 now. That doesn't normally happen, within the level of people that we interact with, let me say it that way. There may be somebody out there that says, okay, I'm going to pick you up, you're going to sit down, chew on the couch, get your nails and your hair done, and keep it clean for when I get home. But those days are pretty much gone. So it really depends on what type of how you came about. Now, if you're a business person and you have, say, if you're both attorneys, you both understand each other's hectic schedule, I would suggest that you have date night, I would say once a week if at all feasible, unless you're in some big trial situation. Then again, because you both understand each other's craft, okay, you get it, you know. But you have to go back. It's like people say, don't forget where you came from. Well, don't forget where the relationship started.
True.
It's the same concept.
Yeah, exactly.
If you forget how you met, where you met, things that drew you together, then you're going to fall short. You know, they created the date night thing, but I'm pretty much of a female that, if it's Valentine's Day, I'm not going to get all upset. Well, I don't have, you know, anybody that does it for me anyway. I'm not in a relationship. But if it's not Valentine's, I like unexpected things. I like just because things. They're more meaningful to me than because everybody says it's Valentine's, you're supposed to get a dozen roses at the office kind of thing, you know. It's more heartfelt. You know, a simple thing is, some trinket at the gas station. It doesn't make any difference to me because it just lets me know you're thinking about me. At that, you know, that day, you know, you saw something, that reminds me of my honey, you know, and whatever. I think a lot of people are too materialistic in a relationship. I think it's nice if you come home and, you know, they grilled some, put something on the grill or made a salad and a baked potato if it's simple, if they don't know how to cook, or even if it's horrible, you just sit down and you eat it because you should be thankful that they put forth the effort and was thinking about trying to make your day better.
True.
People get too weird about stuff like, oh, well, you know, I don't eat that. Sit down and shut your mouth and just eat it. Because it makes that other person feel inadequate when here they're trying to show some sincerity in the relationship and how much they care about you and trying to put forth an effort. If you shut them down in the smallest capacity, I'd hate to see what you're going to do to them in the bigger capacity.
True.
Does that make sense?
Oh yeah, definitely.
So one rose is equal 12 roses to you.
do what? What did he say, Shakur? Because I can't make out what he's saying.
So one rose is equal 12 roses to you.
I heard the 12 roses. Pretty I can't much, make out the part.
Pretty prior. Much what he's saying is that if you got a rose on Friday, on Friday, that would be more meaningful to you as if you was to get a dozen roses on Valentine's Day.
Exactly.
Understood.
Exactly. Yeah, because that just shows me the sincerity of your heart towards me, and it doesn't have to be because everybody else is getting them. Because we're not about everybody else. We're about us.
Exactly. And see, that's where I think a lot of this drama is coming in at, because we I can't only speak on a male's perspective, but from what I hear on a female's perspective, it's a little bit different. Like when I get with a homeboy, I get my homeboy and I introduce him to a girl, he'll warn me once if she's no good. But it seems like when women get in a relationship and they introduce their that person to their friends, it's more of a pushing of do you really want to be with this cat? I mean, does he have this? Does he have that? You know, it's more of a dissection when it comes to. And I understand the concern, but I feel like. I personally feel like men are way more dissected than women, and it's both of our fault. Men for being just strictly after the looks, you know, and women being all women. I don't want to say all men, and I don't want to say all women, but you know, I'm not trying to generalize. But this is the generalization that men go after looks and women go after money.
Okay, but you have to understand something. There's a thing called maturity that a lot of people forget about. I would rather have a man that gets up and goes to work at McDonald's or White Castle than to be the multimillionaire, the 100,000, 70K thing. Because at least he has a purpose and a reason to get up and do what he needs to do the best he can with what he does. What if he prefers to do that? How are you going to tell him no? You already know what I do for a living.
Right.
Right, Shakur?
Right.
I make good money where I work.
But you also put your life on the line at the same time.
I do what?
You also put your life on the line at the same time.
Exactly. But here in our Zay capacity, and nor am I going to try to change them, because that's not what I fell in love with, was to change them.
Exactly.
And again, let me say that. I did not fall in love with someone to change them. There's
exactly.
Too many women out here wanting to play mommy. They
True.
Need to sit down. Do not charge to change a man and what he likes to do. If he chooses to pick up another avenue that he's interested in, say, hey, you know, I think that would be pretty cool. Can I learn with you as well? There you got a partner, you know, in another direction. They may not have any interest in it at all, but they should support you and what you choose to do.
Right.
Say you want to do graphics. She may not want to do graphics, but she should say, hey, you know, I took a little time and looked for some research on some apps and stuff that might help you. Look at them and see. You know, at least she's showing some support.
Right.
She doesn't have to like everything you do, but she should support what you do.
I hate to bring this to a TV show, but I know you heard of the TV show Power.
No. I don't watch TV, so.
I know. That's
no,
why I said
I
hate to bring up the TV
one.
Show. You know, but. Okay, so Power, just to give it a bit, the beginning of the premise. Power is about a man who was the biggest dope dealer in New York. He wanted to go legit. He started off by going legit by starting a club. The woman he was married to did not want him to quit the dope game. Did not want him to quit selling drugs. She, when he said, he asked her, he said, when you look at me, what do you see? And she said, word for word, I see the biggest drug dealer in New York City. This is the woman he's married to. He falls down. This is where this comes in line with what we're talking about tonight. After he says that, he goes to his club on opening night. And on opening night, his high school sweetheart that he was romantically in love with showed up. After, I think it was like 10, 15 years after the last time he saw. She showed up to his nightclub. He ran to her.
Right.
She found out about him, who he was. And the thing about it was, she's a district attorney. Mm-hmm. She's trying to talk him to get out of the game because, A, she don't want to see him fucked up in the game. And B, she loves him to the point where she wants to be with him romantically. And if he gets out of the game. So now this is where this question of, does romance really need to be in a relationship? Because him and his wife really had no issues as long as he stayed in the dope game. But since he wanted out of the dope game, the woman that he had a romantic love for is telling him to get out of the dope game and will help him in the dope game. Who do you think is the right woman for him to be with? His wife?
The attorney. No. His wife is there because of the the stereotyping, I'm boss man's woman, you know, blah, 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 the street thing, you know?
Right.
And I'm protected and, you know, we got this and I'm bougie because, you know, I can be. The woman that's the attorney, first of all, to be an attorney, you got to be fairly intelligent anyway. And she's looking out for him as the man that not only her heart, but her mind tells her he's a better person. To me, I think the attorney old girlfriend would be better for him because not only that, she's also self-protecting of him because she wouldn't have come to him and said, look, you know, I want to help you. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. So she's already being protective of him and supporting him in the change that he needs to go to. Because she wants better for him. So, yes, now she is supporting his movement of getting out of the game.
I took off the applause off the effects, but just for the effect.
Oh.
I couldn't have put it any better than that. Because a lot of people look at it as if he loved, and again, we're still talking about romance and a relationship, so don't think we're just talking, I'm talking to the audience right now, don't think we're just talking about the show Power, even though it is a very popular show that everybody's talking about, but this actually shows a point in real life where you have to be able to recognize who loves you and who is in love with you, because people can
like your friend, your cousin, right, he was talking earlier about, you know, what I said, the learned behavior, okay? So this, anybody can be maybe not from the streets, but they end up in the streets, and then they get, you know, the fame thing in the game of drugs. Then they may come from that family that the attorney ex-girlfriend, you know, would be better suited in that situation. So he's going to be attracted to her in a different kind of way than he is the one that he's in the game with.
Right.
You see what I'm saying?
Right.
So his heart and his mind will feel differently towards the one that's the attorney in a totally different capacity than the one he's married to that's bougie because of the drug money.
Right.
A whole different mental concept there. You know, women, people fail to understand this. And I think I mentioned this on another show we did, Score. A man is visual and a woman listens. What you tell her is what goes through her ears, to her brain and her heart or wherever else she wants it to go. Mm-hmm. A man looks at a woman and says, oh, damn, that's fine. Look at that ass on that. Oh, shit, you know.
Right.
But he doesn't stop and think that all of that changes the same as a male's body changes. Okay? Yeah, so. Now, you can hook up with a woman that's had a couple kids, and no, they're not 20 anymore, but they're still fine. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
But you have to understand that a woman could be a lot more fluffier than what you desire, but if you take the time to know her, you could fall in love with this woman that would be there for you 1,000,000%. Not 100, but 1,000,000. But most men won't go past the body.
Well, sometimes it's more than that. It's intellectual in the conversation.
Well, see, that's my stimulation. Mm. That's what gets me like, whoa, is I like intelligent conversation. Mm. You don't have to know what I'm talking about. Even sometimes just listen to what I'm talking about. You know, just listen to me the same way I'm going to listen to you. True. But you can still learn from each other. Does that make sense?
Because it's the popular vote of the caucus. You know, you want to actually have the north side locked down before you enter the south.
Right. So you know, intelligence is a very sexual thing to me. It's very sexual to me. You know, it's the same as... let's just say you already did what you needed to do and everybody's all happy and laying around and you have an intelligent conversation. There's some people that can't talk.
Ooh, you hit that right on point.
They cannot talk. They don't want to talk. They do not want to talk about nothing. You ask them, do you know if it's going to be 72 or 36 out tomorrow? They're like, well, I don't know. Well, let's ask Alexa. And they're like, well, no, I don't care. Have the dogs been fed? You know, I mean, did you feed the bird? I mean, they don't want to talk about nothing ever. But people fail to understand that once you've been together in the unity, that is your time to be comforting and loving to each other, or whatever it is you want to talk about, as long as they ain't argument.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? So that's your time to be emotional and together and you know, physical together or whatever it is
right.
that you want to do. Yeah, that's that time.
Because it's the that's romantic
like,
time.
Do what?
It's the romantic time, right? You have to set up the mood
exactly.
in order to
do what you want. Fall asleep in each other's arms. I mean, I'm not going to get into my habits, but, you know, do whatever it is you want to do.
Yes.
But that's your time together, you know?
Yes. Because it's not all about the material, right? It's all about the intellectual conversations that you're
right.
Okay.
And we as women like to say things about 50 times and then we shut up, we get it out of our system. If you all don't let us repeat it about 50 times, we're gonna keep bringing it up.
That's if you
all say
clearly.
Things one time and you're done with it, but that's the way you were conditioned and that's the way we were conditioned.
Yes, that's true. Because it's like a unisex type of deal out here nowadays. Everything's unisex. And I feel like as far as everything being unisex, you know, women will grab something from men and men will grab some things from women. But I don't disclose, you know, why women can't give their man hearts or chocolates during Valentine's Day just like a man can give a female.
Exactly. I gave a guy flowers one time, and he looked at me like I'd lost my damn mind. I said, well, okay, well, that won't happen again.
That's not the right reaction, because he's supposed to be happy about what you bring him.
Exactly, and I think that's romantic.
Yeah, I think that's romantic, too. What'd you give that out of 10, romantic?
That's actually the definition of romance.
Okay, you got it.
Like, doing things just because. Not because, the society is talking about, we have to do this. No, you don't have to do this. You want to do this. That's what, when the relationship comes in the form of we have to do this, that becomes no longer a relationship.
Right, and then you have to understand people's schedules. I'm not the type of female that if you say, hey, babe, you know, I know such and such this day, say your birthday. I know your birthday's on Friday, but, you know, I don't get paid till the next Friday.
Yeah.
You know, are we good with that? You ain't even got to say nothing to me like that, because if I'm in a relationship with you, I pretty much know how it goes. And I'm not even going to, it don't make no difference to me. It's another year. I'm not going to get caught up. And people do not, and Shakur can tell you this, people do not, and especially women, do not come up and say, oh, what'd you get for your birthday? Because they already know I'm going to turn that exorcist head and snap on them. Because I'm not that kind of female. You do what you can when you want to, if you want to. I don't care if it's a little card that you made, that you got crayons and made for me. I would cherish that. Because it's something you took the time to do to make for me, even if it's little stick people. You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Where so many women are so materialistic, they want to be flashy to their friends, and oh, hey, we got a limo, and hey, we did the... Please, save your money and don't get a limo.
Right. And a lot of things to it I never understood was where these females get with somebody because of money. They don't never take the time to stack money up for themselves. They're just there to spend his money, and then when he falls off, they just fall off with him, and then they move on. But if you was going to be in it for the money, at least stack your money, invest into your future just in case this person falls off.
You would think that would be the smart thing to do.
But since they're only focused on what this person has, they're focusing on what this person has. They're not focusing on what they can get. And when they do focus on what they can get, it's always in a negative connotation.
Mm-hmm. Now, truthfully, if I wanted to be the very vain female, which I'm not a vain female at all, but I can teach some of you that are a good, intelligent lesson here. If someone's going to buy you a BMW, but they leave it in their name, guess what? It is not your BMW.
It is not. You're just driving it. You're the chauffeur.
You're just the girl that buzzes around. Now, I used to date a guy back home that we dated for about 3 months, and all of a sudden he just got all crazy about me. So he had a big old Tahoe. I mean, it was pimping, but he was like, no, here, you take the keys to my car, I'm going to drive yours, my truck, and you drive I'll drive yours. I'm like, why? Really? I felt uncomfortable. But, I mean, everybody knew his vehicle. You know, it had the big rims and all that stuff on it.
Right.
But everybody knew his vehicle. I'm like, I don't need to drive your vehicle. No, because everybody's going to know. Everybody knows my vehicle, and they're going to see you driving it. It's kind of like I was branded. You know what I'm saying? Like, she's my girl. She's driving my car, my Tahoe, and blah, blah, blah. And I really felt real weird for a long time because I'd never had anybody do that before. But, I mean, I got it, but, I got the what he was doing, but it made me uncomfortable.
Yeah.
It did. I felt real weird doing that.
Yeah, and see, and it's,
I didn't like it.
It's backwards for men because men, that's what they like. On the, if it was opposite, that's what they want. They want to be able to drop their girl off at work and keep their car.
Because it's a privilege, right? It's a privilege.
It is. It is a privilege.
It is. And but you have to understand, I was always taking care of me and what I drove. Do you see what I'm saying? If I wanted a Tahoe like that, I probably could have went and got one. I drove a Charger Hemi, okay? But I was like, I never had a guy say that before. So it didn't make me feel uncomfortable. I mean, I'm being honest about it as a female. But it took me a while to kind of get over that.
And see that.
But I mean, I get it, though, you know?
And see, this is where it gets a little tricky at, because he did that thinking it was out of romance, but... Like, it was perceived differently, you know what I'm saying? Because of the fact that there are no gentlemen, or what is it called? When you ask for chivalry, there is no chivalry anymore. So, women
but
don't...
I explained it to him. I did. I mean, we had a very good relationship. I explained it to him. I said, no, that's okay. I'll just drive my own car. And he's like, no, this is what I want you to do. And then it was like 2 days later, I guess, because he was a pilot for barges. So he was gone, you know, like 24-hour, 48-hour thing, and then back and all
that's
that.
A good job.
So, I just told him, I said, well, I'm going to tell you something. He goes, what's that? And I go, I said, this really makes me feel uncomfortable. And he just grabbed me and hugged me, and he goes, I don't want you to feel uncomfortable, but I want you to know that, and I'm not saying that my Tahoe is nicer than your car or anything like that. He says, this is just what a real man does. He wants everyone to know that you are my woman, and we see each other, and we're with each other, and that's just what men do. And then once he explained it to me, I was more comfortable with it. Let me explain that to you. But until we had that conversation, I was very uneasy.
Because you didn't know what his intentions were.
Exactly.
And this is where it gets tricky again. Because there's women out here who see that as being game. When it's not. It's... like, okay, I can tell you from my experience, females in my lifestyle, they want to drive your car. They want to be seen in your car because it means one thing for them. They own you.
Oh.
Yeah. And they don't want to see no other female try to get with you, even though they want a man who is wanted by other females.
Oh, you mean kind of like when a dog marks his spot. It's territorial.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly. Exactly. In our lifestyle, letting a woman drive our cars is just like them pissing on our tire. It is now theirs. So if any other woman gets found driving our vehicle, guess what? There's an issue.
Oh, okay.
Yes. Now, this is where it gets confusing at, because just because I let you drive my car, I was really being a gentleman, but a gentleman in a friendly way. You know?
Okay.
And so when you see this other woman in my vehicle, driving my vehicle, you're thinking, oh, this, he gave away my position.
Oh.
Yeah. When it's not like that. It's not like that at all. There is no position to be filled. We are friends. If there was supposed to be a romantic relationship involved, then you have to show me that you want a romantic relationship to be involved, not just you driving my car.
But the romance would be to have the gas filled up and, you know, the car cleaned out and stuff like that.
Well, that's to me, I call that common courtesy.
But it's also romance. I mean,
it can be, depending on how, like how Connie said, he had to explain that to her. So if she did that and explained it to me, you know, it was because I got love for you that I did this. And not because, oh, you let me borrow your car, so I made sure you had gas in it. Because I would let a friend borrow my car, and hopefully they would put gas in it to replace the gas that they use.
But it's not.
See, I always put gas in his Tahoe and stuff like that. And he used to chew me out. He'd say, here, take my card. And I said, no, my name ain't on your card, and I don't want it on there, but it's already filled up. And he said, well, I want you to quit doing that. I'm just going to leave the money on the table, because I had a key to his house. Like, I'm going to leave the money on the table and you go ahead and do this. I said, I'm the one driving it. You know? And I just felt that was being respectful, even though I didn't ask to drive it. I was made to drive it, so to speak. But no, I would put gas in it.
Yeah, because that's you looking out. Because, A, my thing is, before we can be in a relationship, I think we have to have that friendship level down pat. Because how was this supposed to be your best friend and y'all was never friends to begin with?
Thank you. Because there's a thin line between love and hate.
Mm-hmm.
So when it comes to that
area, I mean, I would go buy like ribs and chicken and stuff and grill. We'd grill and stuff like that. I didn't charge him for food. You know what I'm saying? So that's kind of how it got. You know what I'm saying? Where I'd be at his house or wait for him to come home. You know, that kind of stuff would flop back and forth. We only lived a few streets away from each other. But, you know, still, that's just how it was. But it was something for me to get used to because I wasn't used to that. I wasn't used to, you know, swapping cars and keys to houses and, you know, that whole thing. I mean, that was a whole new experience for me. But it was what it was. I mean, we're still friends till today, you know what I'm saying? But I think some people, I'm going to speak of the female half, they just look at that like, oh, well, I'm just going to be driving and driving and driving and driving because I want everybody to know. But, I mean, we did have a romantic relationship. But we had fun. I mean, when he was off and I was off, we had fun. We wouldn't come home at 7, 8 o'clock in the morning.
Wow.
We went out and fun. We danced. You know, we hit strip clubs. I mean, we went all over the place. But we had fun. That's not how we met. We met through some people we mutually knew, but still, I mean, we would just have fun.
And that's what if you can't have fun, if it's all about struggle, then that's when I think the true intentions come out. Because I honestly believe that since over 50% of the fucking divorce rate is all based off of finances, there was no love or romance there from the beginning.
Well, let me say this. There's a lot of women that will go to strip clubs with their guys. But if a guy pays attention to a stripper, she feels all, gets it all in your feelings. Then, girl, you just need to stay home.
Right.
That's what strippers are supposed to do.
Right.
I'm not worried about her equipment because I've got all that and a bag of chips. Like one guy at work said, oh, my God, that's a bologna sandwich and a full bag of chips. I've got my own equipment. I'm not intimidated by another female by the way she looks. I'm very comfortable with the way I look. I'm not going to go get no alterations done or nothing. I got what I got, you know. But if you're going to go to places like that with your man, don't act crazy.
Right.
Oh, you looked at her. Well, he's supposed to look at her. But at the end of the night, he's looking at your face.
Right. You need to be questioning him.
Because I used to go watch male strippers all the time. Yeah. So it's like, okay.
You need to be questioning him if you take him to a strip club and he ain't looking at no other women. Now you need to be worried.
Now, I promote you. Now, if you pay for his dance, it would be a little different because you have more confidence in yourself and actually that your bag of chips are actually good, right?
Well, yeah, but women make their own self-esteem.
True.
There's some women out here, I don't care how beautiful, how wonderful, how whatever it is that you tell them 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, the only time they're going to believe it is when they choose to.
Okay. So as far as showing evidence of romance and stuff like that, you can never explain to her how much you love her, you just have to show it.
You can explain to her that you love her. You can show her in the best way that you're able to show her. But her self-esteem is her self-esteem.
Okay. Okay.
She may not feel that she's beautiful because of whatever may have happened in her past or in her childhood.
Okay.
So she's only going to believe that if she chooses to believe it.
Right.
You let another female stand up by you, and truthfully, I've had this happen before, and where I went up and talked to a guy that I grew up with, and his girlfriend just went off.
Mm.
Oh, who the F is her, and that B, and all that. I'm like, what the pump your brakes, chick? I've known him since he was in diapers. For
right.
Real.
So would that
because
be?
She looked at me and went, uh-oh, felt threatened, not knowing that we grew up together since we were little kids.
True, because he didn't introduce her to properly into her life like he was supposed to.
He didn't get a chance to before her claws came out.
Okay, okay.
And see, this is back to the show Power, you know what I'm saying, with the lawyer and the drug dealer's wife, you know what I'm saying? Like, a lot of people, when he saw her in the club, he ain't seen her in almost 20 years. So he ran up to her to catch up. And his wife saw that. And instead of coming to introduce herself and be like, hey, how you doing? You know, this is my, you know, I'm such and such. I'm his husband. I'm his wife. You know, how you doing? I just felt like, you know, I need to come over and introduce myself. first thing she did was she called for her ride. Since she was, they had money, she called for her ride, and then she started playing with herself while she knew the ride, the driver was fucking looking at her through the rearview mirror.
Damn.
Yeah.
Well, here's a philosophy for y'all. If you're with a woman, whether you're casually dating or just met, whatever it may be, if you're out with her, it is a date, period. Okay? You want to meet at a coffee house, whatever, that's a date. And another female comes up and you don't introduce the woman you're sitting at the table with. This was my friend, because that's all you are at that time. There's no committed situation been talked about. But if you do not introduce me, say, hey, this is Connie, my friend, I really don't have a lot to say to you anymore.
Right.
Because if I was somewhere with you, you know what I'm saying, and a guy comes up and says, hey, you know, I want you to meet Joe. I've known him since he was 12. We went to high school and all this. You know, this is so-and-so, my friend. That's being respectful.
Oh, yeah.
It doesn't mean you have to put a label on him or her. It's just showing respect.
Right.
Now, if you don't know what to call her, just call her by her name.
Right. Exactly. And see, the reason why I said that she should have went up and introduced herself is because at the time that he saw his ex-girlfriend, he was not with, what, they was married, of course, but they wasn't standing next to each other in the club. She was in VIP, you know what I'm saying, enjoying the life while he was out running the club. You know, so different. It would have been a different story if, like, if he saw her while sitting next to his wife. He'd be like, "Hey, baby, I want you to come and I'm going to introduce you to somebody. She's a long lost friend. I just seen her for the first time." But he never really got that opportunity because when he saw her, he was nowhere near his wife.
Okay, but here's what the wife should have done. She should have just held her position where she was, and more than likely, the husband would have came back and said, you know what, I just ran into somebody I hadn't seen in 20 years. It's a done deal.
That.
She, the wife, instead, was showing him she's inferior automatically by the look of the female.
Exactly.
There you go. Problem solved. She's sitting there with all that money and all that clout, and she's feeling inferior of another woman.
Yep.
Well, yeah, because that money and that clout and all the bougie-ness does not resolve your inner issue.
At all. At all. All it does is magnify it at any bit of a level.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And the magnification is on her. Because she's going to be that witch that you get to walk home to, because her claws are going to be out ready to go get up in your face. You know what I'm saying? Not, hopefully, not literally, but you know what I'm saying.
Yeah, she's ready to, she's ready to attack, because she already seen somebody that's better than her, but she's not going to let you know. But when she attacks, she's letting you know.
Mm-hmm. She's letting you know. She's going to let you know by the bittersweet, because you're going to notice she's gone. You're going to wonder what happened. And then when you get home, her claws are going to be out like a bobcat. She's ready to get you. And you ain't done nothing wrong. But that's her inferiority complex that she has about herself.
Exactly. See, a lot of people was trying to say that she felt that way because she felt betrayed because she loved him.
Oh, that, whatever.
All he did was talk to an old friend. Now, don't get me wrong, later on in the show, they ended up hooking up, and, you know, he cheated on his wife. Wrong, he was wrong for that. But I think this could have been avoided had the wife would have just walked up and introduced herself.
True.
Yeah, even if their conversation lasted that long for her to do it.
Exactly.
Have you ever seen Deliver Us From Evil?
Deliverance From Evil?
Deliver Us From Evil.
Deliver Us. I ain't seen that.
And Gabrielle Union. Perfect example of what is actually romantic. Now, would you like a man to eat your hot food, or would you like a man to tell you that your food is not good?
There was something about the food.
Okay,
that's the only part I understood.
So you remember on Deliver Us From Evil? Okay, well, it was a scenario going on to where a man wanted to date a female, but he was paid to talk to the female and get her number and to take her out on dates. Now, the girl started liking him when she ate her chili, which was super hot. He was able to withstand the heat, and on top of that, she was just a Grinch. You know what I mean?
Right.
So this man actually was able to withstand the first line of defense, which was her food, because it was hot and could none other than men take the food except for him.
Okay.
So now he moved up into a spot to where he's able to take her out on dates. He's able to kind of nurture to her care. But the whole ordeal is she's being difficult because of past relationships. Of who she's been hooked up with. But my first sign was to see if he really liked the girl and if she really liked him. Because there's different levels to like it. There's different levels to love.
Right.
So the romance would be that he was able to withstand the heat of her food so he can actually get to the next level of her superiority, which is her body.
Yeah, because in this movie, let me just clarify something. In this movie, the woman is not inferior, but she has a superior complex.
Right.
She's too good.
Well, here's a rule of thumb. Anytime you've been in a very intense relationship, let me say, you need to wait 2 years before you get involved with anybody romantically. Because if you don't, you're going to carry over what you had from before to the next one. Now, it may not be your issue. It might have been their issue, but you're going to react to it.
True.
Very true. So if you don't get yourself clean free from it all, again, you're just going to react of what, you know, like in the scenario you all are talking about, this woman isn't inferior of herself, but she has a past of people that were not good to her.
True.
Let's just say, I'm assuming.
Because
of that, her reaction is going to be that to you.
Yes.
If she does not spend that 2 years making herself be rid of that past where she doesn't react, then it's just like taking dirty laundry and putting it in your drawer.
True.
Because she didn't work on self.
Because self was already supposed to be worked on within the first couple months of the split up, right? Because that was the whole reason for the split up, is to work on yourself.
Yes.
Okay. So are we saying the maximum time to actually give a woman to breathe would be 2 years? Or would it be suggested that you should give a woman space so she can actually find her fire again?
Well, let me explain this. For those that truly know how to work on self, it wouldn't take them 2 years. But those that don't have a clue of what I'm talking about, it may take them longer than 2 years. And some people are going to say they did, but they didn't.
Okay.
You already know the scenarios.
Okay.
So let's just say it would be me.
Yeah.
I can cut you off in a second and give me just about 4 to 6 months. I'm good.
Okay. 4 to 6 months.
But I know how to work on self.
Okay. Because me personally, I've been in the same situation, and I don't think it took me that long. But I mean, like, as far as knowing yourself and what you're actually missing while you're in a relationship, I think that's where you should pick up the pieces to where you're actually trying to find yourself on the way out, you know?
Yeah, but you have to be careful that you're not ending up with things that you became attracted to before that ended up being the nightmare. Because then we as people choose not to look at those impurities. We tend to focus on the things that are exciting to us.
Okay, so eye appeasing. So say,
okay.
So, say if I tell a woman she's the eighth wonder of the world, I mean, and that's how I really feel, but she's looking at me like, I'm not worth anything, I think you're lying. How does that, I mean, like, that really diminishes a man's integrity to actually pursue what he wants because you're showing the lack of interest in what the man wants.
Right, but don't get. Because she's not the one for you. You don't go into a relationship to try to put a bunch of band-aids on the sore, you know, and all the salve on it so it heals right. You're in a relationship to be healthy together. It's not to say you won't disagree about likes and dislikes, but it doesn't mean you're there to fix it.
Okay.
Find somebody you don't have to fix. If they make you feel that way, they're not going to make you feel any better later.
Because that's the way that they was treated in their past relationship.
It could have been from childhood, for all you know.
Okay. All right, so my opinion, I think the biological effect of having a female from my end would be to treat her romantically inclined, you know, every Friday when you get paid, you know, to make her feel superior instead of inferior to the next opposition.
No, I'm not telling you every Friday to do that. Who does that?
Which fourth is date night, and which fourth you have, you know, certain days to which y'all call pizza night or spaghetti night.
What is wrong if you don't live in the same house? What is wrong with saying, okay, maybe you both off are on a Wednesday, hypothetical here.
Yes.
And maybe you don't have to see each other every Wednesday. It's healthy not to see each other every single minute of the day.
True.
Depends on your level of your relationship. Let's just say you text me, go, hey, babe, I'm going to pick up some Chinese food tonight. You want to get together at your place or mine and watch a movie?
True.
That's fine. She might text you and say, hey, I've got a big roast that's been cooking in the crock pot. It's really good. I know it's what you like. Why don't you just come on by when you get off work and eat? Now, she has not asked you to spend the night. She asked you to come by and eat.
True.
Now, if things get probably where they're going to be, chances are you're spending the night. You know what I'm saying? But
okay, okay.
That's the best case scenario.
The best tacos on earth, I'll tell you that much.
You know, so, but for someone to carry and not realize in themselves, by the time they get to a certain age, we all have to understand ourselves. Now, me, I know I got a sharp tongue. I already know that. I know what I sound like. I know I'm very articulate. I know I'm very strong in my emphasis and my words, but that's not what my heart says. But that is how I am. That's my personality. I know that I'm not illiterate. I know I have a very high IQ. Mm-hmm. I know I pretty much can do anything I set my mind to. And I know my weaknesses and my strengths. But I am not ashamed to tell someone my weaknesses and my strengths. I'm not afraid to tell somebody, oh, hey, I'd like to try that, but absolutely not. We are not going there. You know what I'm saying? But you have to find that relationship person with you where they've already worked on self and took care of that. There's so many people running around here dysfunctional. And because of their past relationships or because what they happened as their childhood, they picked that up in the relationships as they got older, and they just continued the cycle through generations and generations, and they're very dysfunctional.
Very.
So as a result, you can't fix it. I don't care how beautiful you tell her she is. I don't care if you spend your check every Friday on her. You're not gonna fix her.
So she's better off left in a broken piece that needs time to heal over a matter of months. Gotcha.
Some people are never going to heal.
Yep.
Because they don't know how to do it.
Yep.
So you think trust would be the first issue in the process of healing and back to romance?
Trust would be a what in healing?
A big issue in your request for romance.
Well, here's the thing with me personally. I will trust you till you give me a reason not to. And it's not because I haven't been in relationships where I should have never trusted somebody, because I have. I've been burnt, fried, deep fried, roasted, you name it.
You know.
But until you give me that reason, now I'm like a cat. I will sit and wait and wait, and I don't like cats, but sit and wait and wait and wait. And then once I approach you, I'm going to bury you alive, because you won't be able to squirm out of it, because I got you.
Yes.
People give you signs of infidelity and non-trusting. We as humans choose not to accept those signs because we know it's hurtful. If you want to give somebody space, you tell them, say, look, there are some things I think you need to work on, whether you understand that you do or not. But you might want to, because it makes you feel better about yourself. And if you choose for us to continue on in the relationship, that's something that you have to do. Because if you don't put it to them in a certain kind of way, they're still going to drag you on and on and on, and the emotions are going to still be the emotions, and then you've spent 2 years, you've spent 5 years, and we're still dealing with the same thing.
Same thing.
I have a friend... Yeah, same thing. It ain't never going to go away. Mm-hmm. I know people that go through this cycle constantly, but I am not a fixer. You know, if you've got some issues about certain things or whatever, like pit bulls, I have two. Mm-hmm. You know, stuff like you got an issue about guns, I have many. But, you know, I get it, you know. But if I have to fix you because of what somebody else did to you, then you should respect our relationship and care for our relationship enough for you to go fix that. Whether our relationship lasts or not, it's better that you fix yourself and what that person did to you. Because you cannot carry the burden of what somebody else did to somebody else.
Right.
Exactly.
But it's not fair.
It isn't at all. It isn't at all. And this is one thing that I feel like with the Kevin Gates, I think we talked about this before. Kevin Gates used to cheat on his wife all the time because it started off like that. Mm-hmm. She felt like he could be better than that. And somebody posted something on Facebook one time, and I think we talked about this, and pretty much it was talking about how it was I forgot her name, but Miss Gates, whatever her name. She had an interview, and she said that she, whenever Kevin would cheat on her, she didn't take that as a personal assault or a personal insult. She took that as him being faulty. So instead of being like taking it personally, she made it personal about him. She would tell him, you know, you better than that. I know you better than that. It's not hurting me. It's hurting you because you're at risk of losing somebody who actually does care about you. So it's not me that's having a shortcoming. It's you that's having a shortcoming as a man. So you really need to actually figure that out. Do you really want me or do you really want them? And a lot of women, they said she was wrong for that, because she should have left him. She should have left him and did her own thing and such and such, such and such. But if you look at their relationship now, she owns 50% of his brand. Not to make it about money. I'm not trying to make it about money, but she not only do she owns 50% of his brand, but he is now a faithful man.
Right.
Because she made it his problem, not hers. She made him...
It is his problem.
It is his problem. And he had to look deep into himself to see him. Because when she met him, he was a stand-up guy. When he cheated, he fell off of that stand-up pedestal.
That trophy
left him. That he was no longer a trophy. Yeah. Because if you was a trophy, you would only belong to one person. And this is how she put it to him. You know, and she didn't take that personally. Even if she would have had to get a divorce from him, she would not have taken that personally. She would have took it as he failed. While we have women out here that's they be with men who cheat over and over and over, and they like, well, it's something I'm doing wrong.
No. And the, you know, that's the unfortunate thing, and I think I mentioned that on that show when we talked about that before, Score, is if you're going to cheat on me, at least have the balls to tell me that we're not really together anymore.
That.
Sexually, at least.
That.
Because I can respect you, even though it's going to hurt my heart, versus me catching you and you breaking my heart. I can't respect you then.
Right.
Either way you look at it, I'm still getting hurt. But at least do it where I can respect you as a person.
Right.
Other than that, you're a piece of shit.
Exactly. Exactly. And you being hurt is not that you don't think you're less of a woman because he's out mm-hmm. there doing that. It's being hurt because you trusted somebody and they broke that trust.
Well, and the, you know, here's a lot of things people need to understand. You know, the long before social media, people were promiscuous. But
with that
being said, it doesn't mean that you ain't a good rap. I mean, for real, that don't mean that you ain't can't put it down or give it to them or whatever. That just means they're always got to chase that other side. And when they chase that other side, in time, shorter time and longer distance for others, they're going to hit that wall. And they're going to look back. You may never know, but they will look back and go, you know, I was just a damn idiot.
Yep.
She was all that. And look what I did. I was worried about that pussy down the street.
Yep. And see, and that's why I love Kevin Gates. You know, Kevin Gates came out with a song entitled Dreeka, because that's his wife's name, is Dreeka. He drops some knowledge in there that's outside of relationship material, but he starts it off talking about, Dreeka, this is what I did to you. This is what I have done to you. And you still stuck by my side. You never once blamed yourself. You always blamed me because I have to realize that I could be a better man. And that was pretty much the first verse of that song. And I respect Kevin for that. Because it's not a lot of... Like, look at... Okay, another hip-hop... a hip-hop figure. Future.
Yeah.
Future got babies by so many different baby mamas. You know, it's... And he takes care of them, yeah, because he makes the money legally in order for him to be taxed on child support. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. But he... I have hardly yet to see Future in a picture of his kids.
True.
Now,
here's my philosophy. I give everyone a 90-day rule. Does that mean I really know you in 90 days? No, but it's going to take you 90 days to tap this.
Right. Right.
That's just how it is.
Yeah, because... Period. In the first 24 hours of you meeting somebody, you're meeting their representative. You're not meeting them.
Exactly.
You're meeting the person that they want you to believe they are.
And we talked about the 90-day rule on
another
on my radio station, actually. And
you know,
people are like, oh, well, that's crazy. If you want it, why don't you get it? Well, you know, if I give my prize to everybody, what is value is it?
What prize? It's not a prize anymore.
No.
It's sand at the beach.
It's a free gift. No.
Right. For real. Anybody can go to the beach and get sand, you know?
Exactly.
But I'm just saying,
I was throwing some in my car from last year.
it's just amazing how a lot of people don't even... After a romantic relationship, what I would respect is a business relationship. If you're with a woman and you agree that this is a business relationship, this is something that we touched on that I actually want you to expound on after I say this. But, you know, in order to be able to make it in the United States right now, it's very hard to do that with one income.
All right.
So... if you feel like you could get with this person and they also understand the concept of why you're getting with this person, and they agree that by y'all two getting with each other would make y'all lives financially better. Like, I really...
It's a partnership.
It's a partnership.
It's a partnership. It's all good.
And
because y'all both signed it.
So are you saying partnership with benefits?
Partnership with benefits, exactly. Okay. There should be no romance involved in those kind of relationships.
Because there's already an establishment of a partnership.
Exactly.
Because that partner, you have to be a partner with somebody and invest. You have to invest in the same
exactly.
thing.
Exactly.
Which would be a home, which be a one car to a home, which both of y'all put the money together to actually endure during your hard times and struggle.
Right.
So when I see things like that, and I actually respect those, but it's when emotions or romance get involved. Now, this is the tricky part. Like, we agreed to be business partners in this marriage. But what if I fall in love with you? What if I send you flowers at your job and you have a work husband? Because we technically are just business partners. You have a work husband, though, and I see you flowers to your job.
That's untrust. That's unloyal. That's not being loyal at all.
Well, see, this is how. Which part? Me sending flowers or her having a work husband?
Her having a work husband.
But we already established this is strictly business.
So the business would be to actually move up and see how far the relationship goes from that work husband to her. Now, I done seen a lot of work husbands and a lot of work wives split up just because they're actually not solid together. You know, one would bend on the other, you know what I'm saying? One would snitch on the other for more accountability in her pocket.
At the job, yeah.
Yeah. So that means the work relationship is pretty much a no when she leaves, because now she has to think about another man who actually might make more money than her work husband. Because remember, she's going off of... value. She's,
now you know what I mean by a work husband, though, right?
Yeah, I know what you mean.
Yeah, like that's the dude she flirts with whenever she goes to work.
Exactly. Yeah. Whenever she feels bad, she wants to feel some type of way. She
right,
goes to,
and yeah. she flirts with them. Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
Like that. With that being said, how do you come across that road? Like, we're in this for business, but yet now I have an emotional attachment to somebody else. How do you go about that?
You're going to have an emotional attachment to a partner that you do business with anyway, because that's family.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, Shakur, I think I can honestly say this. I think we have an emotional attachment because we work together.
Yes.
That's good.
Definitely.
That's good.
Definitely.
I mean, we do. I call him fam. He calls me fam. I mean, we've been to each other and blah, blah, blah. So, yes, we do have that. But we have emotions for each other. Not sexual emotions, but we have family, business, partner, connection, emotion.
Exactly. Which would mean that y'all would have to spend a certain amount of time together off the playing field for y'all to actually have a conjoining relationship
playing
field.
And we do. We talk more on the phone outside of the radio than we do shows.
That's right. A good form of connection and a good form of superior decisions on your part. Because nowadays, you really don't want to live next door to the person you like, because she can have anybody come up to you next door. You know, that's why they say long distance relationship isn't the best, but I think for certain people it might be amazing. Because I mean, like, last thing you want to do is share some of your things with certain people, or
true.
If they're lacking in
I've seen that.
You want to be able to bring it to the table so you can bring light to their eyes. Mm-hmm. That's
well, yeah, but I mean, you have to understand something. Shakur and I started off as acquaintances, and then,
okay.
you know, we built a friendship, and then a business friendship, but we never crossed the line of, hey, you want to hook up?
Because it was already established on what you wanted when y'all first met each other, right?
No.
It wasn't.
No, when we first met each other, all right,
just never went there.
Yeah, our first introduction. Somebody introduced me to her in order for me to get an interview at her radio station.
Okay, so she put you on, pretty much.
Pretty much, yeah.
Okay. So Connie's the senior partner in this.
Well, yeah, you can say that, yeah. Because she had been doing this for a lot longer, but she also did my interview. But during that interview, we was able to connect.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not saying that my interview surpasses some of the other interviews that she had, but we was able to connect on, like, I think it's safe to say this, Connie, that when it came to you interviewing rappers, none of them had the mentality that I had.
Right.
And because he's a boss. He has the boss mentality to actually...
No, that wasn't even it. Because every rapper has a boss mentality.
No, every rapper has a manager.
No. What I mean by boss mentality is that they think they can do what they want when they want and profit from it.
True.
Right.
My appeal was, I'm here to help the ones who are trying to get on.
Okay, so you're pretty much laying down the red carpet.
Sort of, kind of. And it started off, Connie was the main reporter of that red carpet. She was the one that, you know, when the stars walking down that red carpet, she was the one woman that... Who is that used to... I know she passed away, but you remember when they did the red carpet and they had a host? They always had one host, Connie. I can't remember that lady.
I can't think of the name either, but I know what you're talking about.
But yeah, Connie was pretty much that woman. And we was able to work together. And by working together... And like, I would come into personal conflict. Yeah. She would run into personal conflict, and we would talk to each other about it. Okay. She's helped me out of more personal conflicts than our family. Because this, I do want to put this on though. This is my mother's son.
Yeah, we blood.
This is not legal blood. Yeah, this is not no. Oh, this is my bro. No, this is my mother's son. So though, like, so but he would tell you. He would tell you that. When it comes to our family, we have hardly gotten any kind of help from them since our mother passed.
And that's just to go to say, Connie, now, as far as having a backbone or a family to actually have somebody to bring to the table.
Now, Connie has helped me out in situations where it was me and my kids didn't even know where we was going to eat. She helped me with that. It wasn't our family. You know, not saying that a relationship should be built off of what somebody can do for you, but that showed where our relationship was at.
Okay.
It was surpassed radio.
And just for clarity, I'm sorry, but just for clarity, because he was telling me about a situation, I asked him, I said, how far are you away from such and such? And he goes, well, it's right here. I said, well, all right, go on down there then.
Yeah.
Yes.
I tied it into him.
I didn't
didn't ask me. I asked him how far you are to go get this. So see, there's a difference in that type of relationship. He didn't feel less by saying, hey, you got something for me, because we all have our pride. I volunteered because I knew the situation he was in and I could do it.
And it made him a better subject, because you knew he had the will to push through with it. So you knew you wasn't wasting your time at all.
Well, I mean, because I look at Sakura as a very, very close personal friend, other than business.
Right.
Because we do talk a lot off the phone. But we have never, ever, ever said, kisses, love you, bro.
Right.
Hey, I want to come to Corpus, and let's just see how that really goes. I mean, we've never, ever talked about any of that, ever.
Yeah.
But he knows I got him in my heart.
Right. And I got more love for her than I do for some of our family. And we going live right now. So if some of our family hearing this, I am going to make sure that they can actually understand what I'm saying right now. I got more love for Connie Moore than I do for some of our family members.
Which would be our second cousins and our third cousins.
I'm not going to establish them. But for the ones, there's some that fallen up, that I would do more for Connie. Some of our family members could be hurting, struggling, and scraping for fucking anything, for pennies right now.
True.
And because I know where Connie lies at with me, with the loyalty, she can just have a hard time paying her phone bill, and I would give her that money before I send it to those family members. Because the simple fact, it's called loyalty.
And devotion. You're devoted to actually succeeding, and you're loyal to actually be who you want to be in life. That's a good form right. of explanation. Because
and we've
you
always
never know
been
who
supportive of each other. You
exactly.
know, we've had very in-depth conversations about something that I bring to his attention or he brings to mine to make us better at what we do as far as radio and stuff as well. And it's constructive criticism. We don't take it personal. You
right.
know, it's like, well, this or well, that. Well, what do you think about this or that? And we just roll with it. He already knows, most people should, because he normally announces this every time, which I'm going to announce it for you, Shakur.
yeah.
I just roll from the hip. I don't have pre-rehearse. I don't do none of that.
Oh,
it
yeah.
just comes from my brain, you know, because I am who I am.
Yes.
But there's the difference between running businesses, having a partnership, showing the love for the person that you're working with in business, but you're not crossing over.
Yes.
It can be done.
So, would mending be a good part in showing a romance in a relationship, or would that be the relationship, the mending part?
I couldn't make it out.
All right. Would mending be a form of a relationship, or would you leave
mentoring?
Yeah, mending, like trying to
fix the problem.
Like get both of y'all back on the same team. Would you be open to that? Or like if y'all was to ever have romance, pulling away from the question about you and Eve, because y'all
would be. Shakur and I would never have a romantic romance.
Right.
Shakur and I would never do that. Because we have, what we have in business works for us. As a friendship and a business friendship works for us.
True.
If we took something else and added it to that, it would totally destroy it.
Right. And
okay.
I think you just answered this question.
We are our own individuals.
Yeah, you just answered this question. And see, like, my thing is that you have to be friends with somebody before you actually get in a relationship with, but you don't have to be in a relationship with everybody that you're friends with.
No, that's exactly true.
Like, a lot of people get that confused. Like, I even have it to the point where it's this chick at work. You know, we are attracted to each other. But there is no chemistry because I'm on another level, she's on another level, but we're attracted to each other. It goes back to the looks.
Yeah.
You know, will the looks continue? I mean, I'm 38 and I just turned 38 yesterday. And mm-hmm. I still look, everybody say I still look like I'm in my 20s. Mm-hmm. Now,
right.
what happens when I hit 40 and all of a sudden everything hits me? I'm all of a sudden, I look like I'm 42. You know, where would this other chick be at? Because she's on, well, right now as it stands, we are only attracted to each other's looks and the way we carry ourselves. But we don't really know anything about each other in order for there to be some kind of romance. I know she's attracted to me because I catch her looking at me just like she catch me looking at her.
Right.
So, when does the romance start?
Well, actually, I think the flirting starts the romance. It's a matter of y'all getting together and start talking.
Because it's all about facilitating your time and, you know, just going for what you want. I mean, like, sometimes you might not be physically attracted, but sometimes that person...
And by me being entry level and her being in the position that she's in, should we even cross that path?
There's nothing wrong with you having a casual friendship with this person.
Oh, yeah. Now, casual friendship is a different story than romantic friendship.
Exactly. But, you know, here's the philosophy that you haven't heard me say in a while. You can look at a beautiful woman and let her open her mouth and she ugly as hell.
Oh, yeah. And see... And see, that's where I'm at. That's where the impasse is at right now, because we haven't had a chance to actually sit down and talk. You feel me? Like,
right.
And I've sat down and talked with a few females that I could see something with, but because where I'm at in my life right now, I don't want to start nothing with this, with anybody. But I can see something with these people. They have a mentality that I can grow to love. But right. Would there be romance?
Well, look at it this way. If she's in a totally different capacity than you, and you're not really seeing her, and she's not your boss at this place, it may work.
Yeah.
But being in the same room with somebody 24 and literally 24 hours a day is a little much.
Right.
What do you got to talk about?
Right. Workplace romances are they're about more complicated than long distance relationships.
Me personally, I never had a workplace romance. I never actually indulged into that, because I always had somebody on the outside to satisfy my needs, the same that I need if I needed them on the inside. You know, certain urges you just got to keep to yourself. That's why you want somebody when you actually get outside of work to actually help you release the energy, you know, that you gain from work. That's one thing I think is a good romantic effort to actually bring to the table, come fully loaded.
Fully loaded. Now, see, that this is where the trick comes in there. Because, like you said, fully loaded. I agree with that. Agree with that 100%. But do you let them know from the jump that you're fully loaded?
She's going to feel it once you
not her. Not her. Do you come from the jump fully loaded?
Oh, as far as me being professional and doing what I got to do at work? I mean, like, I would consider holding my urges in at work if I had somebody else at home. But then again, if you don't have anybody else at home, it's just like you're jeopardizing your work anyway. You know what I'm saying? Because it's easy to turn down somebody at work if you have somebody at home already. But if you don't, the work, it can get a little bit flirtatious and hot. And, you know, down in this area of South Texas, there's a lot of Latinas, and they can get... And they can get kind of spicy when it comes to relationships and, you know, their feelings. But on other notes, there's other ways to actually, you know, put the fire out. You know what I'm saying? Just make sure they always got what they need and make sure, you know, they have nothing to complain about.
Well, and see, that's the thing. Having nothing to complain about, that's another thing, too, because how do you determine what to complain about or not? Like, I've seen relationships where they're so toxic that they're put what's going on here in her brain, but whatever was going on her brain, it set the motion for her to play with herself while the driver was looking.
Because
I guess she needed to relieve that stress and, you know, say, hey, you want to look at this? Because all that was saying, you want some of this, but you're doing that, and you know they're watching. I mean, come on now.
I like that side, because I just think, you know what I mean, she was actually in a drought, and she actually was faithful to her husband by not going to another man and having another man release that energy.
She did, though, by having another man watch her play with herself.
I mean,
there's a difference in playing with yourself by yourself, and there's a difference playing with yourself with somebody.
But for money, that just means I don't want to label any female that does that. I don't want to label them on my show right now. But I will say, in the instance where if a woman got mad and went and played with herself in front of another man, making sure that the other man was watching, that is a form of cheating.
Yeah, sure it is.
That's straight like that. It's cheating. Because...
Well, then there's some men... Now, score, there's some men... If they're married... And maybe their schedules are really whack or whatever... And she does her because he ain't there... He thinks that's cheating too. Me, I'm thinking, no.
No? Yeah, you're right. And those are insecure men. Those are insecure men. That man is in the same position of that woman who plays with herself in front of another man. They're both insecure. And they need someone else to validate them. Whereas the woman who was at home in the privacy of her own home while her husband was at work playing with herself is satisfying herself.
Right. Without an audience.
And without an audience. That's totally different. To me, that's totally different. Yeah. Because right. Now you're just keeping it ready for when your man come home.
Right. Yep. There's some men that are very intimidated by toys.
No, fuck that.
By toys.
I ain't see, no, fuck all
well,
that.
That's what she's doing.
No. Hey, if she wants me to be successful, if she wants me to be out there working, busting my ass off so that she can have a great life, she can buy all the toys she wants, because when I come home, I am going to be the toy that she's going to disregard those other toys for.
Now, remind you, if there's a toy, there's a malfunction within her social ability to actually, you know, go out there and comprehend what she needed to. She's actually, you know, not giving herself away. You know what I mean?
Right.
Because she has nothing to give away.
Right.
The toy done took it. The toy took all her pleasure. But it's up to the man to actually overlook that so he can actually be superior than the toy. Because a man can take the toy and just break that shit in half, and then what she got now? She got a fully
loaded. Just a second.
Yeah.
Why would you say the male would feel superior? The male should feel superior above it anyway. It does not take anything from her, because for women, it's just like, snap, we're back.
But it vibrates. I mean, it would be the whole vibrating sensation that would keep you afloat and keep you coming back to the vibrator, right? To your toy.
No. What it is a toy, a sex toy, gives you a different type of sensation. That doesn't mean it replaces a man. But you have to understand something as a man. Most women do not have orgasms that probably y'all been with because they fake them.
They fake them, yes.
Just because they're yelling and screaming and acting all crazy like they're having a seizure does not mean they're having an orgasm.
Exactly.
Most women do not know how to have one.
Exactly.
I have no problem because I do know how. But most women do not know how.
Right.
And they'll fake it.
Gentlemen, this is going to be a public service announcement. If she is screaming and hollering during her orgasm, she's not orgasming.
That's like somebody telling you they're having a seizure and talking through it.
Right.
Yeah. It don't happen.
Right.
I only had that happen to me one time, and then everything else I couldn't believe,
you know,
because I actually didn't put my hard work into it.
You know how, I mean, not to get too personal, but the way that I found that out was through a woman. Like, fucking with this one female in Florida when I moved back to Florida.
Okay.
But fucking with this one female. And Connie, we talked about this female before.
Okay, I never heard about this female.
Oh, okay. Catch up on that one.
We will. This is the one that we'll catch up on that one. Anyway. But anyways, like, I've had her tell me, like, when she came, I knew she came. And she, how did you know I came? Because you couldn't talk.
Matter of fact, you interacted when I interacted at the same time. That's how I know you came.
No, not even that, because she couldn't talk. Her eyes rolled in the back of her head, and she could not. She was mumbling shit that I couldn't understand.
Yeah,
that's how I know when a woman is catching her orgasm.
Yeah,
when I be watching, not to get too explicit, Pornhub. .com and I'm watching these fake ass fucking porno with, oh baby, I'm coming, oh shit, I don't want to get too loud, I got my kids now, but anyway. Anybody who watch porno know when it's fake. But yeah, if they're talking, if they're telling you they're coming, they are not coming. I'm sorry, there's no way in hell that is true.
And then, you know, here's the thing that you have to understand. Most women are very embarrassed by letting a man know that she does not know how to ejaculate. She does not know how, I'm sorry, not ejaculate, or have an orgasm.
Oh, she I was about to say damn.
Yeah, sorry, what's a transgender? How's that?
It's 2020, so I kind of get what you're saying.
We all
got to
come out of the closet. Yeah,
most women are too embarrassed by letting you know. I know a woman that was married for 40 years and never had an orgasm with her husband until they got divorced and she met a different man.
That's because she had a different size athlete in her perspective.
Well, see,
and it gave her a different mind frame.
And
no, what it was is that the man took time to arouse her and teach her parts of her body that she didn't know existed.
True.
Yep.
Women are not built to do. We are not like you all.
Well,
okay, you guys can visually and then go. We can't. It don't work like that for us.
But I mean, like, so you actually have to see yourself having one in order for you to have one.
What did he say? I couldn't understand what he said.
So you have to see yourself having a sensational period in order for you to have one.
Do I have to?
Yeah, like, when you're actually, like, getting relation and fellatioed however you should say it, you know, treated nicely.
You have to, but pretty much what he's saying is you have to force your orgasm.
No, you have to think about your orgasm.
I don't. No, I don't, because I know what I like and what works for me.
Yeah.
But most women don't know what to do in order to have one. They don't know that if it feels good here, stay there and see what happens. You know what I'm saying? They start fighting it because, like, oh, it's getting too touchy. No, just let me stay here, bitch.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
They are too, this goes for men too. Men do the same thing. They get too in fear of falling or ending up in a relationship. Even if it's just platonic sex. No, that's not the word I meant. Casual sex.
They
hold themselves back during that casual sex because they don't want to gain feelings for the person they're having casual sex with. And after so many of
that,
you would not know what an orgasm is. Or men, like, okay, I'm going to explain this for, like, with men. If we really want to be with that woman, our orgasms our ejaculations are so much different than when we're just trying to get an ejaculation. When we're just trying to catch a nut. You know, when it comes to being with the woman that you want to spend the rest of your life with, that catching a nut or ejaculation or whatever you want to call it feels so much better. And you do not want to automatically get up out the bed with that person versus if it's just somebody you just trying to catch a nut with.
But it's different. That's what
it is. It's different. Soon as you catch a nut with somebody who you just wanted to catch a nut with,
you
get
when you first meet them.
And see, now this is what I'm getting at. Now, you're right. You're right about that. You're right about that. You got to come forward straight up off rip. I'm not here for just casual sex. I like you, or I am just here for casual sex. You do have to actually establish that rule from the jump, because it's not. If one person in the bed is looking for love and the other person in the bed is just looking to catch a nut, there's two different energies going on, and now all of a sudden your orgasm, because men and women orgasm, your orgasm is not as great as if it would be somebody who you wanted to be there with.
Yeah.
At all. And see, that's where romance comes in at. Romance comes in to me.
The arousal.
Exactly. It is the arousal. It is the getting the person ready to experience not only a bodily or a biological function, but something that is actually spiritual in nature.
And you have to have a connection with God before you go through. That's why they tell you to get married. But then again, you have to test drive the car before you even buy the car. Because then you have to know how many miles on it, if it still got gas, if the tires are good.
That too.
Hand to hand.
That too.
But then again, you have to check out the trunk space. The trunk space is all what counts. What is in the trunk? Is it the spare tire in the trunk? Do she got bags in the trunk? Do she got
groceries in the trunk? Like when you talk about the trunk.
Yeah, the trunk.
Are you talking about that junk in the trunk, you know, that, how much booty she could drop? Or are you talking about, like, what's in her brain and stuff like that? Because, you know, when you start talking about the trunk, I'm automatically thinking about that rear end.
The trunk is the storage, what's in her closet, you know what I'm saying?
If so, pretty much her brain.
It's
her brain or between her legs? I'm confused here.
Yeah, cause
see that. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Cause
sexually, she's not gonna just open her trunk and tell you every man she slept with before. Because that's even if you know better, you're not supposed to do that. So even if she had like some skeletons in her closet, you know, it would come out the trunk as far as being, you know, like a bad mother or a good girlfriend, or, you know, if she has any stalking exes around, or if she's just, you know, if she just needs help, you know, because some of these women are still good, but they just need a helping hand, you know what I mean? So you actually got to give her the benefit of the doubt of what she got in her trunk, and then you got to subtract the worst thing she got in her trunk and then push her forward.
And so see, this is where I feel dating comes in at. Dating, you hitting it on the first dating night period doesn't mean nothing.
It's a dating period.
It's a dating period. It's courtship. Yes. You know, a lot of people, we've lost the art of courting.
As far as like romance and picking up because of certain lack of resources.
And I actually want to get Connie's thoughts on this. When it comes to courting, is it still existent?
When it comes to what?
Courting.
Courting, okay.
Is it still existent?
I think it should be. I think it is. I don't think many people do it. Pretty much people are all about just having sex.
Right. And that is the point that we've gotten at, is that we have to test drive the vehicle before we get it.
Exactly.
Now, yeah.
Well, here's the thing. Wait a minute. Here's the thing. There's a lot of people that test drive prior. There's a lot of men that feel if they don't test drive it the first time that they don't want it, which even they've never, you know. You can't base a relationship on sex. And I'm going to tell you why. Because you don't know that person's history, and that person don't know your history.
Thank you.
It's a learning situation between the both of you. How you power drive may not be what she's used to, but it's all about communication then.
Yes.
So then again, we go back to phase one, talking.
So it goes back to the intellectual conversation and the capacity of what you know to actually speak and say from your mind from what you actually want to get your partner to understand. Because there's different levels to it as far as being like courting, casual dating, because it could be simply a one-night stand. But then again, in her mind, if she give it up too early, she's going to be vulnerable for the next date. So it's all about the maturity of this female to actually decide if she wants to give it up on the first night through romance, or she want to give it up on the second night just because she's, you know, she needs to relieve some stress. Because there's different levels to it.
Let me ask you a question.
Yes.
Now, Shakur, you know what I look like. I don't know if he knows what I look like or not. I have no idea what you look like.
Who, me? I'm 31. Go ahead.
Let answer the question. She's going to prove a point.
Go ahead.
But here's the point. I can lay with you in bed stark naked and not have sex with you.
That's because that's the woman's mentality. I have actually been through this. I have actually been through this. So comparing the contrast, yes, that's true. But it's hard for a male to be in the same room as a female if the situation calls for the vulnerability. You know what I mean? Have you ever seen that movie Love Jones? Like,
no.
The guy slept on the couch. The girl went upstairs. She said she didn't want anything to do with it. But at the end of the day, he went upstairs, and they both had, and they both did what they did. Even after she said she didn't want anything, it's just all about the connection.
Okay, I gotta stop this conversation right here before I let y'all go further. RD, this radio station is used for explicit language. So if you want to say they went upstairs and fucked, then they went upstairs and fucked. Okay, they didn't do their thing. They went upstairs and fucked. Okay, I just want to stop that. Now we can continue with the conversation.
They went upstairs and they had sex, but at the end of it, it was casual because they were confused. Nobody said anything about them liking, well, wanting to move on to the next level. And you think that would be a problem if a female doesn't open her mouth and tell a man that what she wants because she's always feeling like certain men should come to her and certain prospects?
I can only speak for myself and speculate for others, but if I just want to fuck you just to fuck you, I mean, that's what I'm going to tell you. I just want to fuck you, bye.
Thank you, because it would be the first thing to hit the fan. You'd be like this. You're like, let's get some weed, let's go to the room, and let's do what we got to do, because y'all are attracted to each other.
Not necessarily. Not necessarily. I mean, you know what? In a way, that may be true, because I've tried being a gentleman and ask women out on dates. And I've seen these same women who that turned me down for a date and a free meal at that. I want to put that out there. A free meal. They turned down my free meal to go get some free dick.
Right.
Free dick is a lot cheaper than a free meal. Because she probably don't want to spend the time for the free meal as far as getting free dick. Because I done took a female out. And I called her afterwards, and she didn't pick up. But
right, from the beginning, because she got that meal.
Because from the beginning, I was just like, "Hey, you know, would you like to go out and eat?"
Exactly. Yeah. But you will find that the one that gave her the free dick will continuously give her the free dick
because he let her know what he wants.
Even still, let's say it was me. What I wanted was to give a free meal, have some conversation, have some companionship, something like that. Nowadays, but women don't want that nowadays.
You better be coming out to say, you look sexy, let's go to the motel.
Well, no, you can't say all women.
Okay, I wasn't going to say women. You're right. And I wasn't going to say women. I was going to say girls. That was the word that was in my mind. And women just came out my mouth. I do apologize.
Let me ask you this. Why do men, and I think all people want, women want to know this. I know this, but yeah. I'm going to just ask it.
Uh-huh.
And each one of you take a turn explaining it. Why do you all think you got to have a big dick to make a woman happy?
See, it's all about the position of the dick. If the dick is outside, it's not going to work. But if it's inside, then it's going to make her super happy. Now, it's all about the woman on receiving this God blessings from which she doesn't have because they're manufacturing it in other ways for her to actually scream for the dick. Now, I'm screaming for the vibrator. That's not going to work. It's not going to work. So now when she's asking for compassion and love, now she's trying to cuddle afterwards. You know what I mean? She's trying to get her booty rubbed on, you know. She's trying to actually feel like somebody can go to the kitchen and make her something to eat, you know?
Okay.
My response to that is I never believed that it was the size of the boat. I always believed that it was the motion that boat made in the ocean. But that was when I was insecure about my penis size. In my first few relationships, I never believed the girl who said that I had a big dick. I never believed that. And I always thought it the reason why was because I would lie to them about what I like about them in order to get them in the bed.
True.
Ah.
So, I felt the same game was being ran on me But at that time, it was because I was also, I had my own apartment, had my car. Actually, I had two cars. You know what I'm saying? I was in the game. Let's just say that. I was in the game. I had money. You know what I'm saying? I would go to different bars. This is a corpus I'm talking about. And in Atlanta, it was a totally different story. You know, it was because of the people who I knew.
Yeah.
But when it came down to just me, that was Corpus Christi. You know, I would go out to this bar called Rat Daddy's and I would perform Tupac, How Do You Want It? You know what I'm saying? Then after that, I would perform my own music. So I thought it was the fact that I was known. It took me, like I honestly thought I had average. I thought I was average size. Like, I thought I was satisfiable size.
What is average size to you, Connie?
I don't even...
But if we can get that for you, Connie, what is average size?
What's average for me? What I've been up against, or
yeah, what's
average
the,
in general?
I would say
look wise, I would say eight.
Eight, and that's without it being excited.
But now you have to understand something. 8 inches long is not the circumference.
Exactly. See, now that's what I was in the. That's what I was always in the mentality that I wasn't packing the way I was supposed to be packing. But it turned out that, like, even when I broke up with a chick before I met my kid's mother, she still wanted to have sex with me because of how I had sex, not because of my dick size.
Right.
It was because, like, for me, almost everything is on the table. Almost everything is on the table. I'm real freaky when it comes to sex. You know, I'm not the type that you're not just gonna lay there and you say, oh, no. That's that you being lazy. I'm doing all the work. Fuck that. It's time to switch positions. We're finna find a position where we both put in work. We're gonna do this shit together. This is how it's supposed to be.
It's an equal exchange.
Exactly.
You're trying to prove actually better than the next person.
I like how my boy Pac said it. It was a fair exchange because, you know, this brings up a good topic. Where women feel like that they have the best thing going for them. And I'm not talking about you, Connie. I'm talking about females, some females in our lifestyle. They feel like they have the best thing going for them because they have what we want. But the thing about that is, this is my mentality.
Right.
My mentality is that I can only catch one orgasm.
There's some males that don't want females to do anything. They want to do what they... It's like they have to be in control.
Right.
Like 100 shades of gray.
Right. So if they're used to that, that's what you're going to get.
Good move.
And that's not what... That's not what I want. You know, I ain't going to lie.
Right.
50 Shades of Grey is some scary shit to me. And I'm going to tell you why.
I apologize.
I'm going to tell you why. I ain't no way in hell I feel comfortable putting a woman in handcuffs and doing all this crazy shit with her when I first meet her.
No.
I feel like that's a setup to me.
Well, I'm just going to let you know right now, you can't put me in handcuffs, but I got some handcuffs to put you in.
Hog tie.
Right?
You can hog tie, you know.
Now see, if I trust the woman, that I'm game for.
Yes.
I'm game for all day long because then I got the bruises. You feel me? I got the risk, the handcuff bruises. If anybody go call the police, it's going to be me, and I'm not going to do that. You know what I'm saying? But I have seen
Christy in my uniform.
Hey, we're not going to talk about that badge, you know, because we're going to have to tell you to put that badge off to the side so I can do whatever I want, you know.
You're under arrest.
I got a badge on my shirt and a badge on my belt, so watch out, cowboy, and my testicles, so you're in trouble.
Oh, I'll tase up real quick, man. You feel that? Yeah. Oh, yeah.
See, well, now, I don't know. I'm kind of scary about that. I ain't going to lie. The last female that I was actually serious about, kind of, you know about it. We talked about it before. But not to put a business out there, because hopefully not everybody that's listening just don't know who I'm talking about, but she had a chair, and I was hoping to God that I would once be able to experience what that chair is like. You know, never happened. But after it came about that we knew that I was going to be able to experience that chair, I watched, I can't remember what movie that was. Oh, it wasn't even a movie. It was Archer. I was watching that cartoon Archer.
Ooh, that's my favorite show.
Yeah. And one of the episodes, Archer's mom had a dead body that was sitting on a chair that didn't have a seat.
Right. It's like the basket. It's an oriental basket. It'll hang from the ceiling and you twist it and you sit in it and it spins.
Right. See, now that's cool. But what was going on in this situation, without him having a seat, she had all access to his everything. Genitals, sure. His dick, and his asshole. But right. She used that in an aggressive way. She took a bat, or not even a bat, a chain or some shit that ended up hitting. Okay, in a minute, we're going to have to base some breaking news here, Connie. But after they finish the story, then we got some breaking news. I know you don't want to talk about this subject, but we have to have some breaking news on this, okay? Anyways, but in the cartoon Archer, Archer's mom used to take something and hit the dude that was sitting in the seat where the seat wasn't at. You know, pretty much just speaking of it. It was some weird, crazy set shit. But can I see that?
Yeah.
Now, real quick, I just want to bring some breaking news. We'll be talking about this on Revolutionary Hour if we have the power to do that. But it's breaking news right now. Well, actually, it's as of 7 hours ago that the National Guard has been activated by President Trump in reference to this coronavirus.
They've already been placed.
No, it's national now. They've been placed.
Oh, everybody.
Yeah, they've been placed, but now they're active.
Okay, well, that means I'll be living at work.
Yeah, you're safe. I don't know what we're going to do over here. Can you make a phone call down here to Nueces County and tell them they don't fuck with Mr. E and King Rubies and their kids, you know, and the kids they got? But yeah, I just wanted to bring that up. We're going to talk about that on another show, though. More than likely tomorrow night. Connie, I would love for you to enjoy to join us on that show because you actually have.
I don't get off till 11 o'clock Eastern, so.
Okay.
That's 10 o'clock our time, so that's kind of perfect. You know, 10:30 or 11:30 your time. If you want to do it, we could definitely do it. I really want to talk about this because with the National Guard being that's kind of serious, and a lot of people is going to take that the wrong way.
Right.
And we need to neutralize because just because they've been deployed does not mean that martial law has been declared.
Yeah, they are putting curfews and stuff like that.
Right. So I want to talk about that. That way people, because people are finna panic. Starting tomorrow morning, people are going to panic. And I want to be a voice of reasoning on that. But that's going to be for tomorrow night.
I'll be able to do it at 10:30 your time, sure.
That'll work. So everybody that's listening right now, y'all make sure y'all tune in tomorrow night. We're going to finish up this conversation here, but tomorrow night we are going to be talking about the National Guard being deployed and what's the difference between the National Guard being deployed and martial law. So y'all make sure y'all tune in tomorrow night on the same radio station, and it's going down. If you ain't been following us already, y'all make sure y'all find us. You can find Connie Moore on Facebook. You can also find Mwah XO Radio. That's MWAH XO Radio on Facebook. You can also find them on Spreaker.com. Y'all make sure y'all follow Adele. Y'all can also follow us at Southside Bosses and BOSS Radio on Facebook and Twitter. I'm sorry, Facebook and Instagram at Southside Boss Connection. You can follow me personally on Facebook at one Gutter Baby or on Instagram at Boss of the Southside Bosses. Tune in for that. But now I want to continue because we only got like 40 minutes left. I want to continue this conversation tonight. So y'all tune in tomorrow for that more info on what's really finna happen. You feel me? Yeah. So now, with that being said, back to what I'm saying, that was their way of making romance stay alive. Everybody has a weird way of making romance stay alive, whether it's, you know, taking your woman out once a month, once a week, or whatever, or taking your man out once a month, once a week, and whatnot. We're going to you got to actually be able to show your romance in different ways, you know. And one of those different ways was how they did it on the cartoon Archer, with the missing seat, and the dude wanted to be violated. Hey, that's what your thing. If that's your fetish, that's your fetish. I have a foot fetish. I can't judge nobody on they fetishes. All I can do is just say, I believe romance is something that should be in all relationships when it comes to being in a romantic relationship.
Let me explain something about me and what I think is romantic. When you come home, there's going to be a note. Meet me at such and such place. But I want to act like you don't know me. Oh. Because I want you to pick me up.
Oh, that's role playing.
Yeah.
Sure.
That's after a while when the relationship gets deep.
No, that's... Nah. I feel it. That's role playing. And
right.
you should always role play.
That's fun. Because you can have that one night stand, but with the person that you're with.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right. It's the one night stand.
You can be that hard to get. You can wear that, you know, bustier and, you know, leggings and your, you know, stilettos or whatever it is you want to do. You can be all that and spice it up for him because that's something he ain't seen. Now, I'm not telling you to run out there and go buy a bunch of clothes, but you know what I'm saying.
Right.
So, sit at the bar, sit at a table, or whatever it is, do something different, you know, that you don't get to do on a daily, and have him come up and ask if he can sit down if you're by yourself, you know, the whole thing, that is sexy and romantic, and then go to a hotel and just do it.
Exactly. Exactly. It's like you're cheating on each other with each other.
Exactly.
And see,
you know,
I think
you're having fun with each other like it's new, and just, you know, it's not as easy as it sounds.
It's not,
because you can't say, "Well, I told you yesterday." No, you can't.
Right.
You got to act like you just met.
Right.
Yeah.
Like one thing I can say about the best relationship that I had, Connie, you know who I'm talking about. I can't really. All I can do is say lobster on this, and you know what I'm talking about.
Right.
Okay,
right.
What made our relationship so so adventurous was the fact that one of us can be subjected to disciplinary action because of what we was doing.
Right.
And it made it seem like it was... we had to keep it undercover.
Yes.
You know, and that was something that made it exciting. Once I rectified the problem of us having to keep it undercover, that's when the excitement went away.
Right. Well, and you have to understand some things. It's just like having sex in a car.
Right.
You know? I mean, in a parking lot, high rise. I mean, it's exciting because you wonder if you're going to get caught.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, I mean, everybody's got little fantasy things or things they want to do or whatever, and that's what you do for each other. It's just like I had a situation where I said, well, I think once a month we go out somewhere, and no matter what, whoever's turn it is, you got to do what they want to do. Now, that doesn't mean something harmful or weird that you know they wouldn't like. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
But say if they never went bowling before, you wanted to go bowling because you used to, they have to bowl. It's just real simplistic. So I think that's kind of fun, too, because if it's something you've never done before, you might find out you like it.
Right. Right.
You know, something different.
And it's... That I feel like that with that being in place, that actually helps strengthen the romance of the relationship. So I gotta say, romance has to be a part of any romantic relationship.
Yeah, it has to be. I mean, don't forget the flowers and the candy, because you know she gets the popping. She might even twerk for you if you bring the candy and the flowers.
Right. But and I know some thoughts out there that would twerk it down for you for $40. You know what I'm saying? So you know it's all about content. You know, I can't remember what movie that was. It was similar to Pretty Woman. I'm gonna use Pretty Woman because you know most people know what Pretty Woman is with Julia Roberts.
Oh, I remember that movie. Yeah.
And who is the dude?
Holly Greer or something?
No, the dude.
Richard Greer.
Richard Greer. You know how? No, he met her in her profession, but he tried to get her out of that profession. I don't know if he even tried to get her out of that profession, but he wanted to show her how he felt about her. Now, if a man can show a prostitute how he feels about her, I don't understand what's wrong with anybody showing anybody how they feel about them.
People are afraid of commitment.
Yes.
It's like, and I let the world know this, because, you know, we're both global. I hit all out real hard out of the United States. I'm sure you probably do, too. We haven't talked about that in a while. But I have no problem with letting people know that I love you, but I love you in a certain kind of way.
Right.
I don't love you as a boyfriend. You know, but I love you as my friend, my family.
Right.
People in general have a difficult time in saying how they feel because they're scared of getting hurt, or they're scared of this, or they're scared of that. If you live your whole life being scared, you're never going to find out if you're ever going to be happy, and you're going to be in a cage.
You're going to feel like you're in a cage in a zoo, and like you're on display for everybody to see your pains and emotions, right? Okay.
Yeah. I mean, so, you know, there's nothing wrong with loving. I love most people, even people that are my enemies. I have mad love for them. You know, I'm going to exercise that a little harder. But at the end of the day, if I care about somebody, I'm going to say, you know, I really like you. I think you're nice. But most people are very intimidated. Now, you have the other side, people on the flip side hearing it, they might run scared because they're not used to hearing that as well. So maybe they may take that out of context, you know. So it's a twofold situation. But people have gotten away from expressing conversation, you know, true conversation. I am not going to get in a relationship with somebody I cannot talk to.
Right.
You can forget that. Shakur, you already know. Forget that shit. It ain't going to happen.
Exactly. Because that means there's secrets.
Yeah.
There's a trunk space. You're definitely gonna get something out the trunk you really don't want if you open it up. That's why it's called Pandora's Box. But Pandora's Box only exists if you're actually in a relationship.
Well, and then people, and he knows this as well. I'm an open book. I don't care what you want to ask me because I don't have a damn thing to hide.
Right.
If you want to walk around and act like you're a Puritan, just go ahead and keep sticking your head up in your ass. But I'm an open book. I've made mistakes. I've screwed up stuff. I've done a lot of things I probably wouldn't do twice, but I tried it. But anyway, at the end of the day, I'm an open book.
Yeah.
And a lot
I just think everybody should be. It eliminates a lot of issues.
It does. Because when you leave people on, that's when things get hectic. That's, I ain't gonna lie. I don't know what happened with Lorena Bobbitt and her husband, but it had to be something serious for her to go that route. And for people who don't know, because I know I got a lot of millennials here, and I count millennials as being born around the year of 99 and up, you know what I'm saying? Not no 82 right. to 96. I don't know where the hell they got that shit from. 80 to 89 were the 80s babies, and we grew up as 90s kids, and 90s to 99 were 90 babies, so I don't know where the fuck they got that millennial shit from, that we're the millennials.
Right.
No, the millennials was born around the year 2000. They are the ones that's licking toilet seats and going around opening up, I don't know what the fuck, ice cream? right? When they opening up ice cream and licking ice cream, those are millennials. Anyways, back to what I was saying. In my day, back in the 90s and the 80s, in the 80s and the 90s, you were straight. You had to be straight up with each other. It was right. Too much going on at that time for you to not be straight up with each other. Now, people want to pretend to be in a relationship.
Yeah, fakeness.
Yeah.
Listen, Shakur, I've got to take this call to work. So
oh, already,
if I'm not
I understand.
When you guys finish up, much love to you. Appreciate it, okay? And I'll be there tomorrow night for you.
Already, appreciate that. We was actually going to go ahead and play some more music. So, Connie, thank you for joining us. You have a rest. Good night, all right?
All right.
Glad to meet you, sweetheart. Talk
nice
to you later.
Nice to meet you, too. Bye. Talk to you tomorrow, next day.
Already. Yeah, no, that was Connie Moore of XO Radio. So y'all make sure y'all tune in to her. Y'all be able to find her on Facebook and on Spreaker. You know what I'm talking about. If you don't think you can find her, join our group at Southside Bosses and you'll be able to find all of that. We are also looking for underground artists of all kinds of fucking music. We're looking for reggae artists. We're looking for R&B artists. We're looking for rap artists. And we're looking for hip-hop artists who promote conscience music. We're looking for that conscious music for Revolutionary Hour. So I hope y'all send us y'all music. If you don't know where to send it to, send it to southsidesubmissions@gmail.com. Also, you can follow us at Southside Boss Connection on Facebook and on Instagram. You can also follow us on Twitter at SBC Movement. You can also follow me personally, Mr. E the Gutter Baby, at One Gutter Baby on Facebook. And you can also follow me on Instagram at Boss of the Southside Bosses. This is King Guru Bees that was fucking with us tonight. So y'all make sure y'all, hey, tell them where you can find them at.
Man, I'm trying to promote. Let me start off by saying I'm trying to get my own little company growing off the ground, man. It's been many years, of trying to get ahead of this game. So it's all about one thing, man, making moves in 2020. It's a hot boy summer, 2020. But at the end of the day, you catch me on Reverb Nation/REDE, and I'll be posted up there all day. Or you catch me on Facebook on the Naval American, N-A-V-E-L, American Original. That's what I be posted up under. But then again, if you see me on the streets, just throw a chunk up the dudes. You know how it is. I'm down here in Texas. I'm out.
All right. And this is your boy, Mr. E, Boss of the Southside Bosses. Y'all still listening to Passion Hour. I hope we was able to cover some viable information for y'all tonight.
Yes,
but now I'm going to go ahead and put y'all up on this underground. When I say underground, I mean underground. R&B, because, you know, that's the only way we can find it now. There ain't too much R&B coming out now. But you can definitely find it here on BOSS Radio Sunday nights. You heard me? And this here is Climax. If you remember that group Climax from way back in the 80s, this is them right here. Shout out to Sheriff Cooley for me playing this here. Y'all heard me? You already know what this is. This is Passion.
To leave my condo to come to this. Well, I'm back, but this time I'm with my man. And these women are putting their hands all over his Yamamoto Kanzai sweater, the iPod. And I'm much, much unhappy about that. I'd hate to come down to the level and become a BW, a basic woman. But if they don't stop, it's gonna get scandalous. Being in the neighborhood.
I got a meeting in the ladies' room.
Where's my jewelry?
I'll be back real soon.
Can we talk?
I don't know, but I think you better watch your man.
Better watch your man.
This girl, he's doing like nobody else can.
All the girls are watching him.
If you wanna be sure, you best go powder your nose.
Best go on and powder your nose.
cause I'm not in the mood. Don't slap me, cause I'm not in the mood. Don't slap me, cause I'm not in the mood. Don't slap me, cause I'm not in the mood.
I wanna love you, girl. heavenly mothers crying, seas of children are dying at the hands of the other child. I know her heart is breaking, feel the earth is shaking, but rivers flow from the tears she cries. She cries, she cries, see Rachel's weeping for her children.
Rachel's weeping.
Somehow someone's got to save them.
Save the children.
And if you say that love the answer, why don't we begin? Or will we just on the streets of Brazil, children gathered, shot, killed, begging, mister, can you spare a dime, a dime? System beat my mother, she left me and my brothers, steal for food, that'd be our only crime. If it's a crime, it's a crying shame.
Thank you. snap, snap, you know you feel that. When you're walking out, looking so cool.
Put them up, throw them up, put them up now. Get them up in the air, who's the boss now? Is it you, is it you, is it you, is it you, is it you? Girl, is it you? Put them up, throw them up, put them up now. Get them up in the air, who's the boss now? Is it you, is it you, is it you, is it you, is it you? Girl, is it you? It's okay.
Over and over and over. Balegi Agna. Don't bend the black papillon. What a flight you aduna. Calm a kindly girl. Begum some way Dili magana soha. We gonna touch you, ma. Want it for my young. My boy. Nini. My japuchi. Nini. Sans une bénédiction. Do mama so take it. Sahadi, Fasiene Sarti, Yagbich de Gulune, Donu Lumama Safore, Sentu Mofomo Tunkise, Yaudinga Yagahi, Mabai, Nini, Majapuchi, Nini, sans une bénédiction, Dumama Sateki, Sama. Yeah.